The continuity problem is the only problem there is. It's the only problem we have, and this is the way that I teach. This is the new wine that I bring here, and this is the central teaching. The continuity problem is the only problem that there is. If you abide in that clarity, then you're able to see what's going on here in this world to an unprecedented extent. Your scope of clarity can become amazing. For instance, did you know that the reason why we come into this world is literally to commit suicide? All death is actually suicide. We come into this world to die. Okay, that is the truth, that all death is suicide. So we come into this world to commit suicide. That is a fact. Why, you see? If we look and see the continuity problem is the only problem we have, if we focus on that, we realize that the ego has a continuity problem too. So there are two continuity problems. The ego's continuity problem, the Holy Spirit's continuity problem, or our spirit's continuity problem, which means we're afraid to quote unquote go back home, all right? Because it's where we are now is so different in this realm of trying to die that we're afraid to go home. The difference is too abrupt, we're afraid of it. Now the ego's continuity problem is why we are trying to die, come here to die. Why? Because the ego is telling us that we have a home different than reality, and that we've actually just been visiting reality for a long time, and that it's time now to go back to our true home where we are actually God. This is what the ego says. And that we have a continuity problem with that. The reason why we can't go to our true home is because we have a severe continuity problem. We're too used to quote-unquote reality, and that's why we can't get back home. So we need to take these drastic measures to try to solve the continuity problem that the ego claims it has. Now this is something I don't think has ever been brought to light before. I've never come across this, and it's just bubbling up today, and I'm seeing it for the first time. It says, okay, this explains so much. See, when we wanted to be greater than God, okay, when the idea says, hey, let's be greater than God, let's be prime creator, the mind invented this scenario where we could pretend that this was possible. And what it did was it said, yeah, actually, it said, you know, all this time, we've been abiding in reality with God as a creation, as a thought in the mind of God, as a creation of God. All this, the ego tells us, all of this is actually, you're just visiting here. It's not your real home. And your real home is different, very different than this. Incredibly different than this. And therefore, the only way we're going to have, therefore we have a continuity problem. The reason why we don't go to our true home where the ego says we are God is that we have a continuity problem. And so we have to work on that continuity problem. So here we find ourselves in this world identifying with these vulnerable mortal bodies in a world where everything is mortal, perishable, impermanent. And the ego has made all this and telling us this is the way back home. This is how we get used to what it's like in our quote unquote real home. And that's how we solve the continuity problem. See, this is what you can see. This is what you can see. And that's an amazing perspective. Where now the Holy Spirit takes this ego's attempt to solve its continuity problem, this story that it's told us. And it says, look, you spent so much time in this world, the perishable, trying to solve the ego's continuity problem, how to get back to, quote unquote, your imaginary real world where you're creator, prime creator, that you were afraid to go back actually to the real reality where we're not God, where we're the Son of God, where we're a thought in the mind of God, an eternal life there. And so the Holy Spirit has to then solve the real continuity problem, which is how to get comfortable with setting down the ego's story about how to solve its continuity problem, so we can remember and accept reality as it is. So it gets a little confusing, but if you just keep saying the continuity problem is the only problem I have, and that is the issue, the continuity problem is the issue, then you're able to see the whole spectrum can stand revealed like it has. And it's sort of, that's like solving the ultimate mystery of what's going on here. That's what's really going on here. This world, this bodies, all of this stuff, okay, is the mind has imagined all this, has projected all of this in the service of this idea of us wanting to be greater than God. And it tells us that all this is necessary, that we have quote-unquote lessons to learn here, that we're evolving, and we need, you know, all this kind of stuff. And we identify with this scenario of impermanence, thinking it's solving our continuity problem of how to get to our quote-unquote true home, which doesn't exist. Our real home, reality, is the zero-dimensional pure spaciousness that we call God, that can never crystallize. The uncrystallized, completely free of all attributes, isn'tness of zero dimensionality, pure spaciousness, that is eternal, that is endless, that is infinite, that is everywhereness, omnipresence. And nothing can ever leave that. There's no such thing as anything else that's outside of that, okay? So that we need to get back to realize this. But we come here to try and separate from that. And we think we're in a training program. I call it the death-based training program here, is what's really going on, the death-based training program, where we're literally trying to reaccustom ourselves to what we think is our true home. Now, another way that we're doing this in this training program is called memory. It's called memory. This is very important because this dovetails into what a lot of spiritual teachers have taught. They say that what we're really perceiving is memory, and that the brain, the body-brain mechanism, is a memory machine, and it is. It's a memory machine. Whereas what we could perceive, pure perception, undistorted perception, what we're doing, we're taking that and the brain distorts it into a memory. And so what we're actually seeing, as we're perceiving everything, we're perceiving a memory, memories. Now, memory can be like that, right? I mean, if you see something and then look away instantly, you have a memory. You're not actually perceiving it. It can be so fast. It can be just the most tiny fragment of time, as it were, to shift into memory. So the brain is actually producing memories for us. We're not actually seeing what is there to see. We're not seeing it. We're seeing memories constantly. That's all we're seeing, memories. Now, the ego tells us that this is how to solve the continuity problem of getting back to our home, true home, where we're prime creators, is that we have to forget where we have quote-unquote been, which is actually in reality. We have to forget that. We have to forget it. And the way to forget it is to start producing memories of it. So we're not actually seeing it, experiencing it. We are just seeing a memory of it. And then we have a memory of a memory, and then a memory of a concatenation, a mental chain of memories that fade. So you ever wonder why this world is the way it is, where we have all these memories that are fading, constantly fading away. Memories of how I used to be young, and how did I feel back then? I can't quite remember. We're constantly just looking at memories. We're in a state of memory all the time. That's by design. Perception and memory is by design. The mind has designed this as a mechanism to try and solve the ego's continuity problem of trying to remember the place where we're prime creator, which doesn't exist, it's never existed. But we believe we're getting there by being involved with memory. Now, what we're told by the great teachers is that what we need is healed perception, and that is we need to Actually, to be very technical, we need a memory that frees us from all other memories. We need a memory that is stable. We need a memory that is, how do you do that? How do we get free of this memory? We're so immersed that we think that we're living or seeing everything. No, we're only living in a memory. We're only experiencing a memory. That's why our life seems to keep slipping away from us, and we can't quite grasp it because we're into memory. And memories fade. Designed that way. So the memory that frees us from memory is the blessed world. It's called the vision of Christ. Christ means oil, okay? Oil spreads out over everything equally, doesn't it? Like over water, it spreads out. It doesn't crystallize, does it? It doesn't conglomerate in like a big area. I mean, it keeps spreading out. Oil covers, even sheen of oil, the sheen of oil evenly covering something. It's just a metaphor for the vision of healed perception, which sees this sense of sacredness covering everything. Now, how does that heal memory? Well, no matter where we look, it's exactly the same. Same. So how can we forget it? Because it's constantly, we're seeing the same thing. No matter where we look, we're seeing sacredness. So it's kind of like we can't forget it. It's like a memory we can't forget. That's what it's like. A memory we cannot forget because it's, no matter where we turn, we're being constantly reminded of it, constantly reminded of it. And so this is very similar to knowing pure spaciousness. It's very similar to it. It reminds us of that. Because in pure spaciousness, it's all that is. It's everywhere. There's no place where it is not. Right? So you can't forget it. It's impossible. You cannot forget it. So the vision of oneness, also it's called the vision of oneness, where everything has this aura, this feeling of blessedness, of sacredness, no matter what you look at. And the key to it is, there's no exception to it whatsoever. There's no exception to it whatsoever. If we make one exception, we won't see it. We won't see it at all. Because the whole effectiveness of it is in the fact that there is no exception to it. That is the entire effectiveness of it, in that it's seamless. There's no place where it's not. It is a seamless totality to it. Make one exception and you're breaking it into you're not seeing it. You won't be able to see it. Because you'll be looking at something different. You'll be looking at the ego's continuity. Think about the ego of going into memory like, oh yeah, I remember the vision of blessedness. It's like this, except there's an exception. I don't see it everywhere. I see some exceptions here. That's already being turned into memories, plural, of forgetfulness. And so you're not seeing sacredness. Sacredness, by definition, actually is non-exclusive. It doesn't exclude anything. Nothing's excluded. That's the whole effectiveness of it. Without that, it's not effective. So it's super important to make sure you don't make exceptions, that you're not holding out saying, yeah, I want to see everything sacred except for this person or this situation. That's why it's very important to not get into disputes or arguments with people. Otherwise, you're going to feel like you need to exclude somebody, and you will not see this vision of sacredness, and you will not solve the Holy Spirit's continuity problem, will remain unresolved, which means you're still in the grip of the ego's continuity effort to solve that continuity issue, which is unsolvable, because there isn't some other reality. Totally unsolvable. So we just come to this world to die in vain. All death is in vain. Okay, we come to die in vain. We come to suffer in vain. We come to fall into memories in vain. All memory is in vain, except the memory of sacredness. And we call it a memory because it's a memory of pure spaciousness. We're not directly knowing. Pure spaciousness can only be known. It cannot be perceived. It can only be known. It's known, zero-dimensionality cannot be perceived, it is known. But for the sake of continuity, we perceive a sacredness that symbolizes spaciousness. Now, people may think they're seeing spaciousness. They're not. It cannot be perceived. That's why the great teachers say, beyond your liberation, as it were, is an even greater, something beyond even liberation. But that is not important for us, because we need liberation from the ego's continuity madness, right? So we accept the Holy Spirit's continuity situation. So there's no getting around the fact that we are enmeshed in a continuity issue. We either are going with the ego's plan or the Holy Spirit's plan. There isn't any other plan. It's all about continuity here, totally. So this is how to center your path, is to keep centering. So that says, I have a severe problem, a continuity issue, and see everything that's going on is a continuity situation. That's why we feel we're like in transit. We're trying to get somewhere. The ego's trying to get us, tells us that it's solving the continuity problem for us, but that's a lie, because there is no goal to reach. And if there's no goal to reach, how could there be a continuity issue? But the ego tells us that the reason why we're not reaching what doesn't exist is because we have a continuity issue with it. So the more we learn how to die and get used to impermanence and all this, that we'll then be able to finally accept our true home without any problem. So it gets us to continually keep working on its continuity issue. And we're duped by that, we're deluded, we're deceived by it. But if you see what it is, then you say, wow, okay, this is what's going on. And then you say the Holy Spirit has an answer to that, which is the vision of the blessed world, or the vision of Christ, as some call it, vision of oneness, equal vision, the vision of sameness, the overlay. Is what I've called it sometimes, the overlay, and the overlay of sacredness, vision of sacredness. Now, you can't serve two masters, okay? That is a very important teaching. In other words, what is being said is, you cannot satisfy the ego and its advice on its continuity issue, and at the same time satisfy the Holy Spirit. You can't be successful at both simultaneously. You can't be devoted to both. You cannot. Otherwise, you'll just feel like you're being torn apart, and it's all confusing, very confusing. So most people in the world are devoted actually to the ego's continuity issue, situation, and are trying to learn. and of course they believe the ego's God. They absolutely believe the ego's God, and that God is helping them arrive at their true kingdom. That is what they believe. That's the story the ego tells us. That by coming into this world, submitting yourself to your attention to all this death and impermanence and vulnerability and suffering, that you're somehow drawing nearer to the kingdom. That, you know, this is all a make-believe tale that the ego's telling. There is no other kingdom other than the true kingdom of God. There is no other kingdom. In the kingdom of God, there's never been any death. There's never been impermanence, no suffering, no vulnerability, none of that. God did not create any of that. None of that is a... Everything that God creates in the mind of God is eternal. It's eternal life, without any exception. So we cannot separate from God, from pure spaciousness, and go dwell somewhere else. And yet we believe, the ego tells us that we can, it's just that we're not aware of this because of a continuity issue. So it tells us, oh yeah, God is providing all this for you so you can, to help you, to learn, so you can be saved and enter the kingdom, this kingdom. But that's all the ego talking, okay? All the ego talking about a non-existent place where really we believe we're going to be the prime creator. And of course, it's very different than reality. In other words, it's a place of impermanence. We think we're going to be the prime creators of impermanence. But where is all this impermanence appearing in? It's appearing in pure spaciousness. You cannot separate anything from pure spaciousness. It's impossible. So we've reached this extremely advanced stage right now, where we've been able to see the two continuity issues and the difference between them. the difference between them. The different goals. One is completely futile and is just an aimless wandering, getting nowhere. Zero dimensionality. To actually know it by first perceiving a symbol of it, a quote-unquote memory of it. But it's a memory that is ever fresh, like an ever fresh memory. And how do we keep a memory fresh? By seeing the same thing constantly. And not the same thing, but the same quality. The quality is this blessedness, this sacredness, this super smoothed out tranquility. Everything seems to be abiding in this marvelously wonderful tranquility. And we're perceiving it subtly with subtle perception. This is the basic, high teaching of knowing what we're choosing between so we can make a meaningful choice. Otherwise, we won't be able to make a meaningful choice. And we'll continue to be drastically deluded by the ego. Most people are drastically deluded. And it's tough to turn around that ship. You know, it doesn't happen in a day. It's a lifetime of effort in most cases. I don't know how everyone's feeling. For me, I'm feeling pretty terrible these days. It seems like the collapse, feeling a collapse coming, is really what's going on. Really, I'm feeling it. And it's getting into my nerves and system. I feel like I'm going to collapse. But the new year started out today with people taking profits. Bear market is starting to emerge. Don't be surprised if this is the greatest bear market of all time. Don't be surprised at all. And I would say if people... who are still thinking that they're going to make more and more profits, and everybody's saying, hey, you gotta get into this market. It's like some endless bull market. Some endless bull market going up to 20,000, 25,000, 30,000, all this kind of nonsense. You know, you're being suckered. Maybe there's a few more profits that people can squeeze out, but I wouldn't risk it at all. I wouldn't risk it. Wouldn't risk it. I would say prepare for a bear market in terms of if you have any planning to do. I don't own any stocks whatsoever. So I have no dog in the fight whatsoever. I'm just saying that what I've seen is this extreme bear market where stuff's going to become worthless. It's going to become worthless. And it could happen very quickly. You know, there's a psychology involved in all this. And actually, there's more involved than we realize. But keep in mind, again, the ego's in charge of this world. Remember that. The ego is what is in charge of this world or this planet, what happens here. The Holy Spirit only blesses everything. It's not, you know, manipulating the stock market or anything like that. No, that's not its way. Its way is to lead us to the vision of the blessed world, where no matter what happens here in this world, everything is equally blessed, which is a memory, ever-fresh memory, that then enables us to set memory perception down altogether. It's healed perception. So the Holy Spirit is not, you know, propping up the stock market and doing this stuff. It's the ego that's involved with this world. And remember, the ego is fanatically advising on how to solve its continuity problem, all right? Telling us we have a continuity problem with we can't remember our reality, you know, the new reality. And so all this stuff that's happening in the world, the ego's causing it to happen. It's causing it to happen. It's bringing it about. And remember, what it brings about is death, death and destruction and collapse. Misfortune, vulnerability, all this stuff, which is totally opposite of reality. And it sells us on this saying, hey, you see, this is curing your continuity issue because it's so different than reality. It helps you forget reality. Right? And therefore tells you that's leading to this new golden age kingdom sort of thing that it tells you is just ahead of you always, the carrot and the stick. And meanwhile, the stick is just, you know, beating you down constantly. So don't trust the world. Don't trust the ego. The ego will pull the rug out from underneath you. It will build you up to tear you down. It builds up all these bodies to what? To tear them down. I've always said this world is a death-based training program. It builds everything up only to tear it down, to destroy it. So this market has just been inflated and built up to an extreme extent. And the metrics, as far as real economic health, are simply not there anywhere on the planet. And this is an artificial bubble. And the bear market is going to arise at some point, and it could arise very abruptly, actually. Very abruptly. So abruptly that you may have even trouble getting out of the market. It's a trap. It's a trap. Now, it may go up for a while. It's possible. Because the ego is in charge of all this stuff. And if we start getting hip to it, it may try to keep suckering us in and says, uh-oh, you know, this is not a good enough lesson yet, so let's keep on trying to, you know, build up the lesson here. The ego is constantly trying to teaches us lessons here, continuity lessons. They're supposed designed to ease the transition from God's reality to our new reality, where we're prime creator, which is, again, total fantasy. But it's constantly putting us through the ringer here, constantly. That is what's going on. That's my best explanation to date. And so now you know why the world is the way that it is. And of course, the ego invents all these other cover stories, fronts for what's going on, so you don't see what's going on. You don't see it. It invents, we're on the spiritual path, we're evolving, we're you know, overcoming our karma, we're doing this and this, on and on and on and on. It's all nonsense, all total nonsense. That's not what's really taking place. Those are cover stories. Camouflage. The ego's literally telling us that we are solving in the process of solving the continuity problem of how to get to our kingdom, the kingdom that supposedly we left long ago in order to dwell in God's kingdom. The ego tells us, you left it a long time ago, but now you're getting back to it. Total fabrication, total lie. And yet we're deceived by it, so deceived by it, because we accept the cover stories. There's something wrong with us, and because we know we do have a continuity problem, you see. That's why we get tripped up. That's why I say that you have to center in the, I say, I do have a continuity problem. Admit that. And then you're able to see, there's the Holy Spirit views the continuity problem this way, the ego views it this way. And then you start to begin to realize which one is really is the true continuity problem, which one is the false continuity problem. Without doing that, the ego's got you, because we do have a continuity problem, and that we're afraid to go back to reality because we've been involved in this crazy exercise of the ego for so long. But if we don't recognize that, the ego will use that fear of the continuity problem to continuously convince us to keep on going along with its program. Because subliminally we know, we have a continuity problem. Okay, so I'm working on it. So it seems like we're working on it by entering into this, ridiculous death-based training program. So there is this fundamental factor, the continuity factor, which I have pointed out, is the very foundation of teaching and success. I have one problem. Everybody has just one problem. It's the continuity problem. And when we recognize it and accept it, called repentance, we recognize, I do have a continuity problem, then it's possible the Holy Spirit can show us, look, you see how the ego has tricked you with this continuity issue. And now because you've been going with the ego's plan for so long, or this continuity plan of how to get to the kingdom that you left long ago, it tells you that your real kingdom, which is imaginary, doesn't exist. You've been doing it for so long that now you're afraid to go back to your real kingdom, the real kingdom, which is God's kingdom. So you do have a continuity problem. The ego's lie about a continuity problem has given rise to a real continuity problem now. So you can't escape it. We're in it. We have it. Everybody has it. Everybody has the same continuity problem. So I hope this is helping. It's helping me for sure. This is incredible breakthrough tonight. Incredible breakthrough. I've been praying for a breakthrough because I know I've just coming up short a little bit, and this is it. This is laying it out as clear as it can be laid out, really, fundamentally. And I'm sure for most people it's the first time they've ever heard such a thing. So they'll try to put it into old wineskins. Don't try putting it into old wineskins. That won't work. It won't work. They'll get all confused. People get angry and agitated and confused. They say, wow, you know, it doesn't fit here. You know, this is my old wineskin. It doesn't fit. It's going to burst it. You know, and they get all agitated. Don't put it into the old wineskins. Forget it. This teaching stands on its own. Stands on its own. That the continuity problem is the only problem that we have. And then just all other thoughts, drop them. Let them drop away. Irrelevant. Irrelevant. Keep it simple. Keep it easy. That stuff's irrelevant. And if you're able then to have your thoughts only focus on the continuity problem, then you will be able to see the whole picture of the ego and how it's camouflaged, what it's doing. Okay? That it's actually, that we started out in our so-called separation, our forgetfulness reality, by being told that we can get to our true reality by solving a continuity problem, which has then caused us to be engaged with all this impermanence. You can see that. You say, oh my gosh. And now we've done that for so long, we have a continuity problem with actually accepting reality as it is, God's reality as it is. You can see it. You see it. Once you see that, it's over for the ego. It's curtains for the ego. Once you can see that, and you see it by every day saying, the continuity problem is the only problem that I have. That's how I've done it. I woke up this morning, this 4:30 in the morning, I've got this depressive cycle going to waking up early in the morning because I'm under too much stress. Way too much stress from numerous angles. Drastic stuff, actually. And I said, no, the continuity problem is the only problem I have, nothing else. And just kept with that all day, trying to just stick with it. And then, whoa, it suddenly I saw that it's the ego, you know, this whole dynamic I pointed out in this video became apparent to me, which has never been apparent before, never. So I can tell you that the reason why is, in the previous video I talked how to drop all your thoughts, you know, and stay centered, how to drop all your too many thoughts and stay centered, is keep it simple, keep it easy, keep it simple, 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 only the continuity issue, that's all I'm looking at. I'm not looking at anything else, that's the only problem I have, therefore I'm only looking there. And that enables your attention to be able to see what I've just seen and related to you, shared with you. You're able to see it. Whereas if you're trying to solve all these other thoughts, which is really the ego's continuity game, right? Telling you, oh, you've got all these problems here, you need to work on those problems. You won't see what's going on. You won't see what's going on. So the continuity problem is the only problem I have. The Holy Spirit has a solution for me. You just stick right with that. What is the resolution to the continuity problem? That question. What is the resolution to the continuity problem? And then you'll be able to see the dualistic situation that we're in, we're trapped in. The situation of the ego inventing a continuity problem and telling us that's the bridge to be saved from reality, actually. And then the Holy Spirit has to have us go back on another bridge that actually helps us, reacquaints us with, reminds us of reality. All this can be seen, literally, your mind sees it, because it's not entangled in all this other stuff. All this other stuff will entangle you. I've never seen this before in my whole life, because my mind was too entangled with other issues. But when you can make it a single issue situation, the whole thing, continuity is the only issue there is. The continuity problem, that's the only issue there is. You're able to see this. You're able to see this. So I'm testifying, I'm witnessing that I've seen it, just seen it. Today, just even while doing this video, it became clearer and clearer. And that's the central core root insight, actually, of the whole situation, the entire situation. That's pulling it up by the roots. As long as that root remains unseen clearly of the continuity issue, the ego will always have leverage over you, always have leverage over you, and be able to convince you to keep working on its continuity issue. which will involve you with death, for sure. As I said at the start of the video, everyone comes here in order to commit suicide, period. Except, of course, those who know the truth, who come here to clarify it for us. That's the only exception. Everybody else, they come here to commit suicide. They come here to work on the ego's continuity issue, believing this is going to save them, believing that this is salvation. So there's lots of people in the world who think they're working on salvation. They're working on the ego's plan of salvation. And of course, they believe the ego's God. The ego tells them, they just, you know, think of the ego as God. And so they think, oh yeah, I'm working on God's plan of salvation. It's the ego's plan of salvation, which is to work on this continuity, a so-called continuity issue of trying to forget all about reality, forget about eternal life, right? Reality is eternal life. What are we doing here in impermanence? Obviously, we're trying to forget about eternal life, obviously. it's very obvious. But we see it as a bridge to something greater than eternal life. So we think, wow, well, it's okay if I go through suffering and dying and stuff. When I get through that, I'm going to have something even greater than the eternal life, you know. It's greater than God. We don't say that. We all say, oh, no, I'll be with God. But their God is the ego. The ego is the God of death. And they really want something greater than God. That's what we've been really trying to get, and we're deceitful about it. We don't admit to it. Repentance means to admit to what we've been up to. That's part of it, admitting to what we've been up to. I say the mood of repentance, stay in the mood of repentance, which is a non-argumentative mood where you're examining your own mistakes, not trying to, you know, accuse others and argue with them and tell them you're mistaken. Look at your own mistakes. That's what I'm trying to do with these videos. I'm taping where I see my mistakes, say, ah, I've been mistaken in this, and not seeing that the whole thing started out with the ego claiming there's a continuity problem. See, that was a mistake in not seeing that. So correct your own mistakes. Don't be argumentative with people. Don't be in disputes with people. Jesus said, turn the other cheek, love your enemy, all that kind of stuff. Just don't. You look, be in a mood of repentance, and you see the mistakes you're making, because everybody in this world is making drastic mistakes. Drastic. They don't recognize. Again, this is the first time I've ever heard this. Never read anything like this or anything like that. That this dynamic I pointed out, people are not seeing it. They're not seeing it. That's a drastic mistake. It's a drastic mistake. And in some ways, some have somehow managed to somehow work through it, perhaps, you know, and historically, it seems like they have. But as far as really direct, clear exposition of this, I've never come across this. So, for sure, people in this world are caught up in this drastic self-deception. And the mood of repentance, I've tried to stay in it, saying, you know what, I must be making some big mistake. The last couple of days, I've been very agitated. Because I know I'm very close, and I say, I don't have any more time. I'm running out of time here. The collapse is coming, and I can't get it. There must be some huge mistake I'm still not seeing. I say, how's that possible? I'm willing to look at anything. But I said, stay in the mood of repentance. Stay humble. So you know what? I don't quite get it yet. And it turns out it was true. I didn't see this yet. I had not seen this yet. If you can believe that, it's true. I had not seen it yet. But I was right in that it was easy once I looked at it. It was no problem for me, but I hadn't looked at it yet. That's astonishing. So I'm sharing this advice, stay in the mood of repentance, which puts the burden on you to say, I'm making a mistake. There's something I'm not looking at. I'm refusing to look at something, and that's causing my problem, my refusal to look at that. And so I need to be humble and say, you know what? I need to admit that I've been deceived for a long time. I've been deceiving myself. I've been refusing to look where I needed to look. And so when you see it, you kind of say, oh, wow, okay. So it works. Because I was able to look at this, and it didn't cause me any problem. So the mood of repentance works. saying the continuity problem is the only problem I have. It works. It works. I looked at it. There's a feeling like, oh my gosh, what's going to happen? What's going to happen? You know, it's been so long since I've looked at this. What, you know, something terrible. What's going to happen? I'm catapulted into something. No, nothing happened at all. Nothing's happened. Nothing's happened. I feel fine. I feel just the same as before. Very smooth, completely smooth. There's no abruptness, no problem, nothing. So this path, it works. It works. And again, in order to make a choice, we need to see meaningful options. If we're just using self-deceit and refusing to look, we won't choose. We will not choose. We will not choose. And therefore, we'll be stuck with a continuity problem, which we don't recognize that there's actually two continuity issues at play here. We have to choose which one, the ego or the Holy Spirit, which one to go with, which plan to go with. And we won't be able to make it that choice until we see clearly the difference. Won't be able to do it. Will not be able to do it. And therefore, the ego will continue to have leverage over us because it's got us. We're not admitting to it. And it can continually make us keep on going down this death march that we're on. It's a death march. We come into this world to go on a death march, period. Suicidal death march. That's it. And of course, when you recognize, hey, that's the ego's continuity plan to so-called save us from reality, and I don't need that anymore because the Holy Spirit has a continuity issue which saves me from the ego's continuity issue and actually reminds me of how true reality really is, reality of God's reality. So you can make a meaningful choice then. Covered this, we've done it, and this is a huge breakthrough, gigantic breakthrough. And again, take it to heart. Maybe watch this video a couple times. Take it to heart, because this is looking at the root. This is looking at the root, no doubt about it. All right, very great. That's it for this one.